Well, this panel is intended to launch the monumental publication of the Oxford Handbooks of Africa and Economics. And as you can see, there are two co-editors. Celestin Mongo is the senior co-editor. He was supposed to speak first, but like any African intellectual, he is so humble. And I'm a little bit older than he is. So in that sense, I'm senior, so he gave me the opportunity to speak first. And I'd like to take these occasions to thank Celestin Mongo for his incredible in leadership, intellectual contribution, and entrepreneurship to gather such a large group of outstanding scholars in Africa studies and come up with this book. I'm sure they are going to be right for many, many decades to come. And I also like to thank all the authors for contributing to the publication of these two volumes in a very short time, you know, less than 2 years. And it's incredible in a sense. And I also like to thank Adam, and also Oxford, you know, University Press, for helping us to publish such a beautiful volumes both outside and inside. And the reason why we want to come up with the new handbooks, because we know, you know, Africa is a place which can generate new ideas to contribute that to the world, and certainly Africa also a place which require transformation to catch up with the rest of the world. As I mentioned in the presentation, I think the most important thing for us to have ideas is that we want to use the idea to transform the world. And for this, we want to transform, help the transformation in Africa. And for Africa to catch up the rest of the world, I think the structural transformation and industrialization will be essential. So I'd like to use this short intervention to come up with some ideas that my study of the past in other places and how to use that to help African countries to succeed in industrialization and structural transformation. You know, for me, I think poverty is not destiny, because I personally experienced that. I was born in Taiwan in 1952. At that time, Taiwan was poorer than almost every country in Africa. And now Taiwan became a high-income economy. I went to mainland China in 1979. At that time, the per capita income in mainland China was less than one-third of the average in sub-Saharan African countries. And now China is a high middle income country. And China is likely to be a high income country by the time of 2020. Not only the places where I was born, the places where I worked, also my neighbors like Korea. In the 1960s, Korea were poorer than almost every country in Africa. And now Korea is also a high income country. So from these experiences, some economies, some countries, they were trapped in poverty for a century, but they could take off. They can become high-income, modern country, like any other, you know, high-income country in the world. But the fact that African countries are still trapped in poverty. What are the reasons? We know every country in the world, including those are rich now, they were poor a century ago. And we can look into how come they were poor at that time? They are all relied on agriculture and natural resources for their livings. Okay. And the path to prosperity, all the successful countries, they transform themselves from agricultural resources-based economy to modern industrialized economy, and then to, you know, after the post-industrialization service-oriented economies. And the reason why Africans still trapped in poverty, because African has not really complete this transformation yet. African countries still heavily rely on agricultural natural resources, both in its export and its productions. And the key issues are how to help the African country transform, right? And the reason why to rely on resources and agriculture is not a good way for prosperity, because we know the prices of agriculture and natural resources has a lot of fluctuation. And certainly for that, you want to smooth your income, you need to have good management of your earning of resources for what we know. But that's not enough. If African country want to be rich, to be prosper, African country need to transform from resources-based economy to industrialization. But the issue is how to do it. And I think that structural transformation, certainly you need to have first movers. And the first mover, you have to compensate for the incentive. If you want to move to the new industry and so on, you also need to improve the infrastructure institutions. And the improvement of infrastructure institutions require coordination. So for that regard, the government need to play a facilitation role. You cannot have a spontaneous forces of the market to accomplish that. And the government need to play the role. However, no matter the improvement in the infrastructure or providing incentive or coordination, require resources and implementation capacity. And for that, it's limited for the government. If the resources limited, implementation capacity is also limited, then the government to prioritize the use of those limited resources. So in that regard, to have some kind of industrial policy, identify sectors to use the limited resources and it can generate large return will be desirable. And that is industrial policy. So industrial policy should have a very important role to help the developing country accomplish the structural transformation. Certainly, you may be doubtful because most industrial policy in the past failed. And so, how to make industrial policy work? From my perspective of the new structural economics and other studies, I find for the industrial policy to be successful, the government industrial policy should target a sector which I call the latent comparative advantage of the country. The so-called latent comparative advantage is that the sectors, if look into the factor cost of production, the country can be competitive internationally. They have low factor cost of production. Basically, they are consistent with their endowment structure, the comparative advantage endowment structure. But they are not competitive because of transaction costs are too high. And why the transaction costs are too high? Because they don't have adequate infrastructure, adequate institutions. And the industrial policy should help the firm to enter into the sectors which they have the latent comparative advantage, but their transaction costs are too high, and industrial policy to help should help the firm to reduce the transaction cost by the improvement of infrastructure or institution. But if industrial policy need to target a sector which are the latent in the country, how the government identify the sector which are latent comparative advantage of the country? And historically, we find the successful catching up country, the few successful catching up country, they all have industrial policy. The government all play the facilitation role, but they have one thing in common. In general, their industrial policy try to help the private sectors enter into the dynamic growing sectors in countries which, you know, their per capita income are somewhat higher, not very high, somewhat higher than theirs. And those are the secret of success. And that also give us some kind of ideas how to identify the sectors which are the country's latent comparative advantages. Because if a country can grow dynamically for several decades, then the industry in the country should be basically consistent with the country's competitive advantages. But if they are growing dynamically for several decades, they will accumulate capitals. So some sectors used to be competitive, now those sectors, due to the change in their endowment structure, are going to lose their competitive advantages. And if countries are not too far away in their income and their endowments are similar, the sunset industry in a dynamic growing high-income country will be your sunrise industry. And that is the way to identify the latent comparative advantages. And in the past, fail. You know, industrial policy fail. In general, industrial policy are too ambitious. Try to target sectors which are in country, their per capita income maybe 5 times or 10 times higher than theirs. Okay. And certainly, we have many tools that are to help the country to do the development policy. But those two, from my point of view, you know, have many drawbacks. The first two certainly is the business and environment advocated by the World Bank. And that approach has several drawbacks. The first one, they, you know, try to introduce a whole set of changes, too many changes. The government resources are limited. The government cannot implement 100 changes simultaneously. Second, the first best institution in Hong Kong country is not necessarily the first best institution in a developing country. And the third drawback of that is that they did not identify sectors. They tried to, you know, make it general, but as I said, different sectors may have two different sector-specific infrastructure and institution. So that's the drawback of the World Bank approach. And then you had a gross diagnosis advocated by Daniel Rogic. I think Daniel Rogic recognized that the government cannot implement 100 reforms simultaneously. And he advocates to just look at the mounting constraint of factors. But there are some limitations of his approach, because basically he relied on the surveys of existing firms and to ask what are their mining constraints. But the existing firm may be in the wrong sectors due to the wrong intervention in the past. That's one thing. And secondly, for the new sectors, there's no firm there. How do you know their mining constraints? So this approach has some drawback. Then Ricardo Horseman advocates the idea of product space. You move to the sector which are not too far away from you, so you can rely on the last knowledge in your existing production. There's something water there, but the constraint is that the existing sector may be wrong sectors. And again, new sector may not be there. And then those are the drawbacks. So I try to propose something I call growth identification and facilitation based on my new structural economics. That's the first step, to identify the country which you have similar endowment structure and their per capita income, you know, two times, at the most three times higher than yours, and they are growing dynamically in the past decades, and to see what are their dynamic growing sectors. And those kind of sectors are likely to be a latent comparative advantage sector. As I argue, they are going to lose comparative advantages. And this first step will, you know, have important function. The first one, help to identify the latent comparative advantages sectors and avoid the government to be too ambitious. And secondly, you can also avoid the government to be captured by the private sector, because then some of the private sector will lobby the government to protect them and for all kinds of reasons. But actually, those kind of sectors are not their latent comparative advantages. And they cannot separate that, but they are a way for rent-seeking. So this approach can help with that. And after you have that, you can come to further, you already have some domestic firm entering into those kind of sectors. And if you have domestic firm entering into that kind of sector, the effective cost of production should be lower than your competitors. But how come they cannot be competitive? In general, the transaction costs are too high. And the government should help the private firm to reduce transaction costs by improving the institutional infrastructure. And this step has the advantage of, you know, count on the tacit knowledge, because if you have firm there, they should have that tacit knowledge. And the third step is that some sector may be totally new. If the sector is totally new, then you can invite foreign direct investment from your competitor country, because they are losing comparative advantage. They will have the incentive to come. But why they are not coming? Maybe they don't have the information, or maybe your infrastructure is not good enough. So under that kind of situation, the government also should help to have this investment promotion and also to improve the infrastructure and so on. And this means that passing knowledge can be important. Certainly, we are in a world of which technology changes very fast. So there may be some new opportunities which didn't exist 20 or 30 years ago, but if you have some entrepreneur, identify the opportunity. Or every country has some kind of specific endowment, and you need some sectors which can be in a global market. If we already have some private sector, identify that, and then the government should help them to scale up that by reducing the transaction cost for them. And in a developing country, certainly, in general, institutions are poor. In general, the infrastructure are poor. And as I said, the government resources are limited. And so you need to have a pragmatic way of improving institution and infrastructure. And I think that industrial park or special economic zone would be a good way to do that. And then you can encourage domestic firm or foreign direct investment to go into that. And lastly, the government should provide some incentive for the first movers. And here I'd like to say the difference between the incentive and in the past that the firm in your sector which you promoted should be consistent with your comparative advantage. They should be your latent comparative advantage. And so this kind of incentive can be very limited by tax holiday and so on will be enough. And here I'd like to have two additional points. Structural transformation certainly is very important to move from agriculture to industry and so on. But agriculture itself requires structural transformation from subsistence to commercial agriculture and so on. And in this kind of internal transformation in agriculture, the government should also play a facilitation role. And certainly, and this is also important for poverty reduction for job generation in low-income country. And in resources abundant country, resources can be a curse or aberration. If you use resources to help the transformation by providing infrastructure improvement of institution, then resources can be aberration. So let me conclude. I think poverty is not destiny. African country, like country in any other part of the world, if they have a good policy framework to target the right sectors, they can grow dynamically. But for doing that, we need to have a change of mindset. In the past, we always use high-income country, what they have, what they can do well as a reference to advise African country to do like the high-income country. But here, I'd like to advise African country to should look at what they have now. That's their endowment. And based on their endowment, they must have some sector where they can do well, and then the government should help the private sector to scale up what they can do well. Thank you very much.